online, so we have to start. So again, good afternoon. I'm pleased and honored to open the fourth session of this conference. On this session, we are moving away from Israel and a little bit away from the present time. And the leitmotif, I would say, of this session is it's being a comparative session, comparative between Eliab. Comparative between various periods from the 30s to our time, from comparing to different continents, the United States.
Can you enlarge it at all?
And I would say.
Okay, that's maxed out.
I was thinking that while we'll hear the papers here, maybe there is another comparative aspect to it, to our own time and to our own place, but it's every mind's mind. It's during the lecture.
What I can do is take the picture, but that indicates that you're still connected.
Okay. He's an emeritus professor at the University of Paris, one. He has working on comparative analysis of state building processes and on its influence on the history of Jews. The end of the French melting pot paradigm.
So it's nice to be back here again, and it's really a pleasure to be part of this superb conference. France became a mass immigration country only in the 1920s, and mainly for economic reasons related to the necessity to replace numerous dead in the First World War, almost 10% of the adult population. 1930s, a bit less than.
Thanks so much.
One can argue that a certain proportion of workers went to France instead of the United States, which has become, through its quota system, an almost closed market for immigrants coming from Eastern Europe or Southern Europe. Thus, during those years, France became the country most open to immigrants in the world, a country of large immigration similar to the United States. If both countries share the same large presence of an immigrant population, nevertheless, they differ entirely in this matter in their policies. In France, it's a strong centralized state who's in charge of the policy. New form of statism were invented, allowing a strong governmental control based on the new administrative services and a clear interpretation of the notion of citizenship, implying previously the disappearance of any ethnic collective bond. Whereas in the United States, the decentralized nature of the political system, the weakness of the state, allow foreign immigrants to keep large aspects of their collective identity. Since Tocqueville, it has been a kind of academic traditional exercise to compare the two countries in a more or less sophisticated way. Some scholars apply it in a very telling way to the process of immigration during the time period we are looking on. The melting pot metaphor invented by Israel Sengweil is supposed to be adequate for the US and the assimilation one for France, even if we know that in France, strong traces of collective identities were able to survive, and that in the US, since Horace Kallen's notion of hyphenated identity, the American society invented a kind of multiculturalism, a legitimate form of cultural or ethnic pluralism, allowing the different ingredients of a melting pot to survive. Thus, one could argue that the melting pot metaphor described more accurately the French Jacobine model based on the rejection of any culture or even more ethnic particularism, any idioms, local regional identities, and even a strong naked secularized public sphere, foreign to the American tradition until at least the 1960s. If we can argue that, quotation, the French and American histories of immigration are in far closer than most of the historiography and sociological analysis of them would lead us to believe, if the American example has become a rhetorical device helpful in constructing French national identity, both countries comprise within their polities and histories universalist discourses and discriminatory practices. Finally, what is really at stake is the comparative analysis, the question of the state. We shall not discuss here the permanent controversy between those who look at the American state as a weak or a strong one, even if we argue, even recently, against those scholars who saw the American state as a strong state, forgetting purposely its still valid Weberian definition, quite close, in fact, to the Tocquevillian one, requiring a strong institutionalized and differentiated apparatus from any kind of specific interest like a ruling class, a church, a political party, an ethnic group, and organizing. An organization mastering its own recruitment of its own administrative personnel through its own meritocratic procedure. Thus, if we still use the state as a quasi-independent variable, its own power matters a lot, since it influences any kind of policy, socio-economic, cultural, military, and so on. Then, whatever the similarities, the type of state may still put some light on any specific policy, for instance, in this paper, following our previous commitment to this comparative analysis of the state as a specific variable, we'd like to look at the interwar periods during which France was confronted to such a formidable contrary to many authors, would like to see the involvement of the state as part of its own interventionist tradition. And we do keep in mind the exceptionalist interpretation based on a long-term history. As so, to be short, the so-called challenge of the nation-state must still be seen as different from one country to another one when we consider the type of state-building process which occur in each society in Europe or in the US. And the so-called contemporary Brubaker return to assimilation cannot dismiss the survival of strong differences among different countries having different kind of states. We'll be trying to understand why, during this period, the state abandoned its own universalist paradigm, linking more or less, since the French Revolution, citizenship to nationality, why its assimilation policy declined during those years, threatening the French version of the melting pot paradigm, even if some crucial political actors still sharing those values were able to remain loyal to the French statist universalist tradition. Thus, this paper is more a kind of research paper based on some kind of specific material than a broad and theoretical one. The universalist interpretation of citizenship, molding French exceptionalism, rely heavily on the state seen since Enlightenment as reason in action, a state differentiated from the church, the ruling class, willing to act in accordance with reason, looking at the citizen as person acting within the naked public space. This vision tells us a lot when one looks at the crucial law voted by the French Parliament in 1889, giving a new strength to the jus soli, already accepted a long time ago by the French Revolution, when the Constitution of September 1791 opened the French nationality automatically to thousands of foreigners living in France after a period of 5 years, or if they were married to a French woman. Now, according to a new double jus soli, a foreigner born in France would automatically obtain French citizenship if one of his or her parents has also been born in the country, or on his majority, her majority, if neither has been born in France. Through its elementary school system, thanks to the hussard noir, the black hussard, its school teachers, a rapid assimilation of foreigners could be reached, transforming them in citizens devoted to the French nation state. Whatever the differences between theory and practice, this process was a triumph of Renan's vision against Treitschke and ethnic consideration. In the early decades of the 20th century, quotation by Roald Olefield, the Republican model served primarily to integrate newcomers, turning immigrant workers from neighboring countries into French citizens, just as French peasants has been socialized into a modern Republican via public school and the army two or three generations earlier. 1924, a new law was taken by the first government belonging to the left, allowing French women married to foreigners to keep their original nationality and transmit it to the children. The law of 10 August 1927 was also quite generous towards foreigners, French citizenship being obtained after a quite short probationary period. But then the general economic crisis and the deep rise of xenophobic feelings led to such amount of prejudice that suddenly transformed the whole question of immigration. National rights, the radical nationalist movement, exactly like during the Dreyfus affair, found this law unacceptable and loudly protest against the so-called disintegration of the French national identity. Racist ideas quickly spread. Foreigners were accused to keep their values, to recreate a nation within the nation, to oppose any process of assimilation within the old Christian nation. A strong xenophobic and anti-Semitic mass mobilization occurs and spread everywhere on the territory against the invasion of Metec from Spain or Italy, stealing French jobs. The radical right was launching a mass campaign to protect French identity, seen as a new Babel Tower against any decadence and the Jewish menace, illnesses and its sexual mores, symbolized by Léon Blum's victory at the head of the Popular Front. For Gary Cross, quotation, the French look for a nation to this threat, for a solution to this threat in the United States. The American solution was to exclude foreigners who have potentially social problems and to assimilate and naturalize those immigrants who are socially acceptable. French efforts to follow the American path, however, were to prove largely unsuccessful. Even if 257,000 persons had been naturalized between 1931 and 1936, this way of integration remained a narrow option, open mostly to previous older immigration, and paradoxically, quotation, naturalization would play a far smaller role in France than in the USA. Only 11% of the foreign population in France was naturalized in 1931, compared to 55% in the US in 1930. The state now was abandoning its own universalist principle, kept more or less since the French Revolution, at least at the ideological level. Pre-selection procedures, including health consideration, were put in practice. In 1932, a new law introduced for the first time the principle of quota for immigrants, workers in each branch of the economy. Some members of the French Foreign Office didn't hide their prejudices against Jews, like several consuls in Germany protesting against Jews and telling us that Jews are really in a safe place, they shouldn't come to France, and so on. In 1934 and 1935, conservative administration, led by different heads of government like Flandin or Laval, destroy more or less the right of asylum, leaving, for instance, many Jewish refugees after the Nuremberg laws outside the territory. It's the turning point. Free transport was given to foreigners willing to leave France. The same year, foreigners are no more able to change their job and must ask permission to travel through the territory. In a few years, the foreign labor force was thus reduced by over 22%. The French nation state was, quotation, closing the door, establishing new barriers at the entrance of the territory, expelling foreigners, preventing them from becoming French. The entry visa against German and mainly Jewish refugees aimed to close the borders and led to an easy asylum. Several measures were taken against the possibility to become doctor, lawyer. A person has now to become French since 10 years. In February and July 1935, foreigners working in sectors with strong unemployment for less than 10 years were losing their authorization and so on. Hundreds of thousands of immigrants coming from Italy, Belgium, Russia, Poland, Germany, and now Spain, many hundred thousand refugees who become they were accused to keep their own culture within closed communities organized, breaking the university public reel while sharing often extreme left ideas. Some are considered as spies, thus exciting a strong xenophobia shared both by the middle and the working class. Assimilation is now supposed to become inconsistent for those non-citizens without political right, being also discriminated in the market, unable to regenerate themselves for all those reasons as pure Republican citizens. Immigrants without work permits had to leave. Police launched a series of raid and arrest illegal immigrants. Refoulement and expulsion were applied based more or less on arbitrary reasons. Thus, some foreigners had to leave the country. Instead of being assimilated within the market system like in the US, with large open economy, many immigrants in France remain under the control of the administrative measures more efficient than in a weak state society. Once the state authorities are no more following universalist values, then immigrants can be more severely chased, put in jail, or expelled by the strong police services. Some prefects are clearly implementing such a deeply restrictive and harmful policy, following the explicit orders of the Secretary d'État. In Paris, for instance, the city with the largest group of immigrants, the Préfecture de Police, became a strong controlling power, quotation. The Parisian Immigration Service soon became the envy of the world. The central record hall of the Paris Immigration Service contained more than 1.6 million files and 2.6 million index cards. No city in the world paid closer attention to its immigrant population between the two wars than Paris. Refoulement and refus de séjour increased sharply but did not prevent foreigners to come back to the French territory. After 1931, expulsion raised dramatically and became even greater in 1934, 1935, under the Bloc National government. Things will become even more difficult later on in 1938, when nearly 440 foreigners were living just in Paris. The police surveillance grows sharply. New measures were taken against political refugees and foreigners trying to find a job in France. The traditional Republican hospitality suddenly vanished. In Lyon also, like in Marseille, even there were still strong differences between those important cities, explained by their quite different local position, local political system, Marseille being organized along a clientelist one, foreigners as potentially clients, things became harder and harder. Strong limit, quotation, to the universalist were builded in contradiction with the French Republican traditional paradigms. I'm quoting here a quite recent book by Mary Lewis, The Boundaries of the Republic, Immigration Limits of French Universalism. At the national level, tougher immigration measures were taken in May 1938, giving more power to the police. Automatic prison sentences were applied against foreigners without legal paper. Harsh circulars against the invasion of foreigners stealing French jobs, but also any foreign political activists, were implemented, threatening all the undesirable. Marriage between French and foreigners were now prohibited. previous naturalization were sometimes seen as illegal. The strict closure of the border prevented the entry of numerous Jewish refugees flying Germany, Austria, Poland. Those already in France were banned from the Department of Seine. A special police was created to keep the frontiers. Plans were elaborated to send those refugees already to Madagascar, Algeria, or elsewhere in one of the French colonies. Many camps were thousands of illegal but also legal foreigners in extremely bad condition and harsh discipline. A hardline policy is becoming predominant. The Evian Conference on Refugees led to a deadlock. Daladier and Bonnet's official France has entirely abandoned the Jews. The country of human rights and emancipation has already capitulated. Thus, and that's the main point of the article, thus it seems that there is a clear continuity from 1932 to the eve of the Second World War, and even to Vichy in this policy dealing with the foreigners, being political refugees or people trying to find a new job. Many contemporary authors are arguing that Vichy policy is just following previous hostile measures taken against foreigners in general or Jews. That in this matter also, Vichy is also before Vichy. At the end, they argue that the xenophobic republic already implemented racist laws against the foreigners ideals. This extremely negative vision of the Third Republic has been held by serious scholars. Their aim was to outline the idea that nothing changed during the Popular Front, a regime unable or even worse, unwilling to take in consideration the fate of the foreigners and among them the foreign workers, deliberately neglected with the interest of the native French working class. Among those authors, Jean-Charles Bonnet and Rita Talman raised even if both of them admit that this regime wrote a temporary relative amelioration. More recently, Daniel Gordon wrote that the Popular Front, quotation, did not really change the doctrine, end of quotation, of expulsion, which remained the same from the Third to the Fifth Republic. Summarizing the controversy, but contesting those views, Vicky Caron, in a very known book, suggests that, quotation, these changes cannot be dismissed as minor or superficial. Rather, they constitute substantial reforms. The Popular Front made a sincere and concerted effort to resolve the refugee problem in a humane way. It constitutes a sharp and significant break, not only in tone, but also in substance, with the policies of preceding governments. It may be true that the refugee question did not constitute the Popular Front's foremost priority, but it was by no means a question that was ignored. More recently, some scholars reached the same conclusion. During this short period, in Lyon, like in Marseille, most refugees succeed in having official papers. Expulsion became rare. Many got their French naturalization. It is true that the Blum government did not elaborate a real statute for the immigrants, even if a text was supposed to be written. It did not structurally change the actual policy, but it did allow foreign workers, to vote within the professional election in the factories. It gave equal rights to the small craftsmanship and to the retail profession. It suppressed the territorial limitation of the foreigner's identity card. It allows the possibility for foreigners being naturalized to get access to some job of the civil service. It signs the Geneva Convention of 1933, protecting the Nansens, refugees from Germany, but also the Armenian and the Russian apatrid, trying the best it could to defend the political refugees. It seems that the administration behaved now more kindly, allowing German refugees, mostly Jewish, to get those official papers if they came to France before January 1937. And Roger Salengro, in charge of the Minister of the Interior, asked all prefects to open the frontier to the refugees. Let me skip this page on the Communist Party and the way it has changed its own policy and jump to the next page. Let us look at Leon Blum's speeches. In February 1935, he said that every foreigner should have the right not only to live in France, but also to work in France. There is a moving, very moving speeches in which he would say, you should not build a wall against the foreign people. They should be allowed to live in France and also to work in France. There's another speech, for instance, in November 1938, in the context of the International League Against Antisemitism, in which, after remembering everyone that he has been protecting the black people from Africa or those coming from Vietnam, he would also say that you should not close your house against the Jews, against people coming from Germany. Your house may be already full, it's possible, but when they knock at your door, you must open it. You must not ask them their papers. You must not ask them, even they made some crimes, you must not ask them their health papers. Please, how can you neglect this kind of asyl and close the door? So, Leon Blum is leading the government, and Leon Blum, as an actor, is really trying the best he could, not only himself, but all those who surround him, to change the policy and to really have another policy facing the foreign people. Leon Blum has been had already broken his relation with Maurice Barrès. He would be writing against his ethnic vision of the nation. For Leon Blum, quotation, a nation is not an ethnic formation. It's something which is based on abstract ideas of moral conception. And he would add, French thought is the revolutionary spirit, the one which is linked to the revolution, to liberty, and to solidarity against any kind of oppression. Following the French Revolution paradigm, he's really willing to keep it in his mind and his action. Against Barrès and the radical right, once his close friend, Blum was holding a Renan paradigm of a nation, open to all those who share his vision based on the French Revolution, openness to the world, and hostile to any form of tyranny. It's precisely in 1935, just 1 month before the victory of the Popular Front, that Blum wrote his Souvenir sur l'affaire, his book on the Dreyfus affair, looking back at this crucial moment of its own previous political involvement. Once in power, Blum is surrounded by close friends whose political culture has also frequently been molded by the Dreyfus affair and the creation of the League of the Human Rights of the Citizens. Blum belongs to it since its creation, almost like its closest friends, who are going to be extremely active in favor of the Popular Front. It's almost done. And the fate of the foreigners, one can say that, I'm quoting a very recent PhD on the League des Droits de l'Homme by Emmanuel Naquet, one can say that really the main point, the main action of the League des Droits de l'Homme was to protect the exiled, the refugees in France, and to protect their alterity, to protect them within the nation state and the law of the state. The League, to which Blum belongs since the beginning in 1898, the League is really fighting every day and you can look at the archive, fighting every day against any expulsion of foreigners, but also political refugees coming from Italy, Spain, Russia, Germany, Greece, and so on, trying to protect them in court, protesting against the police action, asking several members of the government who belong to the League to defend them, just the contrary to Vichy politics. Without any doubt, Victor Bach, once a crucial actor in the Dreyfus affair, is at the forefront of this action. Being now president of the League since 1926, he will wrote in January 1935, now we are facing exactly the same situation than the Dreyfus affair. Now again, the fascists, like before, the people against Dreyfus, are trying to destroy the Republic and its values. So we could see that those actors surrounding Léon Blum and being involved in the long history of the Ligue des Droits de l'Homme are all trying to act in favor of the foreigners. Victor Bach, who is going to be killed by the milice very soon, but maybe 5 years later on, and the very known murder, Victor Bach would say exactly at that time, when the Popular Front victory happened, it's again the Dreyfus affair. It's again the time where we make my Judaism awake. If many non-Jewish members of the Blum government are members of the League, like Marius Moutet, Paul Ramadier, Marcel, and some others, I'm quoting a recent PhD by Hélène Perry, Remembering Dreyfus, which has been done in 1998 at Chapel Hill. Quotation, Jews were among the most militant on the interwar committee and assume increased responsibility in League leadership. Bach was elected the League first Jewish president and so on and so forth. One can argue that the League, quotation, has always relied itself on its Juif d'Etat, dedicated to the values of a strong republican nation state and its universalist and assimilationist values. If many of them belong to the French civil service, like Blum, Jules Mock, a crucial actor in this fight, Victor Bach, C. Émile Kahn, Jacques Salomon Adamar, Cécile Brunschwingen, others are lawyers like André Blumel, the head of Blum cabinet, or journalists, but they all share this vision of an open public realm in which foreigners, once legally admitted in France, should become citizens equal in rights. A key actor of the Popular Front policy toward the foreigners, and also an active member of the League, is Marcel Livian, whose father's name was Leibovici, a Jew who came from Romania as a foreigner before becoming himself French. He is also at the core of each action in favor of every category of foreigners in the context, for instance, of the Commission d'études des questions intéressant l'immigration, created in the 30s and led at the beginning by another Juif d'Etat, Jules Mock. Many projects are elaborated, but unfortunately none of them was presented in the Chambre des députés. Even if the Popular Front didn't change really radically the French policy toward the foreigners, its passionate involvement of many of gave hope to numerous foreigners. In its report, Le Parti Socialiste et l'Immigration, a socialist party and immigration, from May 1939, one can find numerous examples of the party involvement, even preventing many foreigners to kill themselves. One can also discover in Léon Blum and Marcel Livian private archives an impressive number of hundreds of them of personal letters sent by German Jews, Spanish or Italian Republican, and so on, asking for desperate help. Most of them are sent to Camarade Léon Blum or to Citoyen Blum, asking his personal intervention against an in favor of a naturalization procedure. Those letters are worth reading slowly. They are extremely painful and desperate. Léon Blum, which is remarkable, Léon Blum himself, and quite unknown, one can find that in is a new archive which has been brought back from Moscow recently, Léon Blum answers often himself personally as président du conseil with his own handwriting, asking more specific details so that he could intervene more efficiently towards the administration, sending to different prefect orders to pay attention to the fate of numerous foreigners. We can quote many of them, let's forget this. Then, to conclude almost, once we take into consideration the seriousness of this involvement relate to the values of the old Dreyfusards, many of them being Jewish Republican, dedicated to the universalist Republican assimilationist values. An absence of a deep change has to be explained. For many scholars, the lower level of the French administration, sharing now xenophobic values, is responsible for this failure. Victor Bach, for instance, sent a very interesting letter. Léon Blum also, in 1935, would say, you are trying to build a very open policy, but at the local level, at the middle range level, the police is really behaving harshly against the foreigners, and they are doing implementing RAF, you know, it means really they are seizing the foreigners and expulsing them. The police is using a strong brutality, and the kind of inhumanity. This is a contradiction against the French Republican tradition, which is really the French Revolution. There are numerous letters, another one by Marcel Livian, and many scholars nowadays would agree to say, quotation, that on the field, the administration was quite open to the atmosphere, the xenophobic atmosphere at that time. For instance, in August 1936, during the Popular Front, a new commission is settled to look at the refugees coming from Germany. 6,280 dossiers were scrutinized. 85% were giving a positive answer, but nothing occurred. Then obviously one can feel, quotation, the blindness of the French bureaucratic apparatus during those years in the way it dealt with the refugees from the Third Republic. It seems that, quotation, in many cities, the new measures were, for instance, in favor of the apatride, had almost no application, 1 minute, even less. At this lower level of the French civil service, it seems true to say that Vichy is before Vichy. This reluctance of the local administration outlined the fact that a strong nation state does no more accomplish its universalist aim, even if its dominant political elite, mainly composed of previous members of the civil service, is still willing to policy based on assimilation. This could explain the relative failure of the Popular Front and led directly to the world treatment itself.
Thank you, Professor Birnbaum, for a very enlightening paper. I hope you enjoyed, like I did, the added historical dimension to our discussion. And now we are moving to the lecture by Professor Martin Schain, who is the professor of politics at New York University. He is author of numerous books and articles dealing with the politics and immigration in Europe and the United States, the politics of the extreme right in France, and immigration and the European Union. He has taught in France and lectured throughout Europe. Professor Schain is the founder and former director of the Center for European Studies at NYU and former chair of the European Union Studies Association. He's co-editor of the Transatlantic scholarly journal, Comparative European Politics. And Professor Schain will talk about a transatlantic comparison of immigration policy lessons from Europe. Please.
come and why did I come to be here? First time I've been in Israel since 1974. When I was here at the end of the war, I want to thank all of you for the job positions in gathering the scholarly exiles since many of us affected. And I want to mention that the presentation of the people today is part of a piece that we've published in the next 6 months that deals with corporate lessons that Americans have learned from Europe. And so I really should begin by saying exceptions. I thought here policy on immigration has been poorly defined and often contradicted. The gap between policy output radical right politics and in some cases policies in Europe. And so I'd be surprised having said that to learn that before I finish
the lessons to be learned from Europe are generally negative, what not to do and how not to do it. The lessons from the United States, which is the other part of this paper, are far more mixed, I would argue, but generally more positive. I want to, in the next half hour or so, examine three aspects of immigration policy in Europe and the United States. The first is, and this is a traditional breakdown, the first is entry policy, the second is integration policy. The third, which is somewhat more controversial, is border enforcement. So let me begin with entry policy. In many ways, this is the most, is this okay? In many ways, this is the most the entry of immigrants for settlement into most European countries has been strictly limited, very strictly limited, for the last 40 years. For most of Europe, the post-war surge in immigration related to the recovery from the Second World War and economic growth ended with the great economic crisis of the 1970s. The relatively open, in some cases desperately open, immigration policy of the previous 25 years before the 1970s grew rapidly to a close, either because of government decisions that ended bilateral treaties, in the case of the German guest worker program, or administrative decisions that ended more or less open immigration to France, or legislation that redefined citizenship, that redefined citizenship in the case of the UK. There are lots of other case studies of this, and this is how immigration came to an end, or supposedly came to an end in Europe in the 1970s, is an interesting question in its own right. Although the political framing of these decisions generally made it clear that immigration for settlement would be very, very limited at best, the word zero immigration was the phrase most often used in France. Immigration nevertheless continue, or immigrants continue to arrive each year for several reasons. And so let me just see if I can look at this. Try this. Ah, there we go. I'll come back to some of the details of this table in a moment, but the reasons why immigrants continued to arrive is first because of court decisions which have come up in our discussions somewhat peripherally on entry, particularly for family members of already resident immigrants. Second, because European countries, in fact, still needed workers in some service sectors and construction, and certainly still in some industries. And finally, because of the spurt of asylum seekers that were admitted during the 1990s. And so legal inflows in Europe If we look at 1992 and then 2009, legal inflows at the EU level were considerable. They were actually higher than those at 25, depending on the year, 1992. Legal inflows considerably represented in the EU. In the EU, they represented 4.7% of the population, which compared with the United States, that is higher than in the United States, which had a legal a more open legal immigration policy of 3.8 per thousand population. By 2009, immigration in Europe in general, had more or less leveled off to about 5% per year in the United States, per thousand per year. In the United States, it was about 3.7 per thousand per year. And so what's striking about this is that although explicit rhetoric of immigration was and remains extremely restrictive in Europe, policies themselves, sometimes implicitly, sometimes explicitly, are far more nuanced. And so if we look at the immigration populations of the United States and the EU 27, and this is roughly 2009, 2010, depending on the statistics I was able to get, the foreign-born population of the EU is now roughly 9.4% of the population. The foreign-born population of the United States is roughly 12.7% of the population. Taking the UK and France, that is taking Britain and France as specific country examples, they are roughly comparable. The foreign populations are roughly comparable to those of the United States. And so Europeans weren't used to thinking of themselves as countries of immigration, but they certainly were, and certainly have become countries of immigration. Now, this in itself would not be a problem, except for the more explicit policy statements and the rhetoric about immigration, about that Europe not being a country that wanted to attract immigrants, compared with the United States, which had a more explicit immigration policy. Since 2000, all major European countries, in addition, have developed programs to attract what are roughly called highly skilled immigrants. Although basically only the UK has been successful in this area. In 2007, the European Commission developed a plan for a so-called blue card for these immigrants, which was enacted in 2009. The advantage of this new permit is that it's applicable to all EU countries that have adopted it. Nevertheless, having said all of this, the real growth of immigration is not among highly skilled immigrants, not at all, but among third country nationals has been among the less skilled, among those who went into family unification. By any way of looking at this, given policy statements by EU countries about zero immigration, about trying to attract highly skilled immigrations, the gap between the rhetoric and the reality is really very, very striking. In addition, the number of citizens of EU member states that are migrating to member states other than their own has increased 10% a year since 2002. While immigration of non-EU nationals, as you can see from this table, has remained more or less stable over the last decade, the part of the real growth in immigration, foreigners in these countries has been from other EU countries. In 2006, EU nationals represented 40% of immigrants entering other EU 27 countries. During the same period, EU nationals returning to their country of origin went down markedly by 20%. This percentage has continued to grow. That is, it continued to grow through the beginning of the economic crisis in 2008. By 2008, 44% of the entries, the foreign entries into EU countries, were from other EU countries, contributing to the growing proportion of resident population in EU countries from other EU countries. More than a third of the foreign nationals in the EU 27 in 2009, that is after the beginning of the economic crisis, were from other EU countries. So, there are decisions in some legislation throughout through throughout Europe that permit, and in the case of highly skilled immigrants, sometimes encourage continued immigration. Although most countries have some sort of residency laws that define legal residency of non-citizens, no country in Europe has passed or attempted to pass the kind of comprehensive legislation on immigration that is comparable to the United States Immigration and Nationality Act, which defines in law both categories for entrance and limits on entries. Therefore, there is a therefore here, criteria for legal entry into Europe remains opaque, often poorly defined, up to administrative discretion in many cases, contributing to what radical right parties in Europe often call the gap between commitments to halt immigration and the realities, as we have seen, the realities of continued immigration each year. And let me take this a bit further. The differences in entry requirements between Europe and the United States have grown deeper over time. During the past decade, major EU countries, and this has come up in our conversations here, major European countries have been moving towards linking entry with increasingly narrow concepts of integration that would ensure, and the phrase is not mine, but was used by Christopher Caldwell in a somewhat recent book on European immigration that was published in the United States, Reflections on Democracy in Europe or Immigration in Europe. He used the word cultural stability, right to cultural stability. And although this right is certainly not established in law, nor has been put into legislation, conceptually, it certainly exists throughout much of Europe now. In an attempt to minimize challenges to the cultural status quo from immigration. So requirements for entry in the Netherlands, France, Germany, the UK, other countries as well, including Belgium and parts of Belgium, have increasingly demanded conformity with national social or cultural norms. Now, this is certainly something that's come up here during our discussions today. I'm not making any judgment about this, but just stating it for the moment. In the UK, Prime Minister David Cameron, supported by then-President Sarkozy and Chancellor Merkel, has called for what he referred to then, I like the phrase a lot, muscular liberalism, to bar state aid to groups that don't share Britain's liberal views, while France and the Netherlands have tightened admissions requirements, that is for people coming under family unification. This also came up in our discussions, even for those seemingly eligible for family unification. Now, American policy on entry, by contrast, if we're talking about legal entry, American policy on entry, by contrast, has moved decidedly in a different direction. Since 1965, U.S. entry law has been strongly biased towards a broad-based concept of family unification that effectively gives priority to families of those residents who were born abroad. At the most basic level, immigration legislation now favors and promotes diversity in other ways as well. The Immigration Act of 1990 included a program of what became known as diversity visas that would eventually provide for the admission on an annual basis of 55,000 immigrants from, quote, underrepresented countries. Entries from these countries are required to have high school equivalency and or work experience, but as everyone around this table knows, they are chosen by this very strange lottery system. All over Europe, countries that are eligible for the lottery at any given time, you can find posters that have been posted by the United States Embassy asking people to apply for the lottery. And so what began as an effort to relieve the backlog of applications from Ireland, an initiative that was taken by Senator Edward Kennedy on behalf of his Irish constituents in Massachusetts, ended as a mechanism for increasing diversity of the population of the United States. And so, just as a kind of footnote, when the House-Senate conferees emerged with a final agreement in the 1990 legislation, they called their compromise an agreement and a victory for cultural diversity, for family unity, and for job creation. It didn't start out that way, but it certainly ended up that way. What makes this statement particularly striking to you, the way it was made, is that even as an afterthought, and certainly it was an afterthought, American political leaders were seeking to promote what European leaders either feared or sought to carefully manage, that is, cultural diversity. As we shall see in a few minutes, questions of cultural diversity at the very core of the problem of immigration in Europe, and the primary reasons that entry has been increasingly linked to integration. Although diversity has been critically debated in the United States, mostly around the time that the diversity clause was passed in the early 1990s, this question has faded from the immigration debate since then. Not entirely, it certainly came up throughout most of the 1990s, but it's faded as a serious political issue. The core problem of immigration in the United States is not cultural diversity, at least from a political point of view, if not from an intellectual point of view. The core problem for the United States is illegal entry and undocumented immigrants who are now in the country. So let me move down to integration policy. The gap in integration policy, it seems to me, is also widening between Europe and the United States. And this came up when, it certainly came up to some extent in Noah's papers, so I won't repeat what he said. Many European countries are beginning to develop explicit integration policy for immigrants that are consistent with the more muscular entry requirements. And I say this because, in fact, although it's not generally appreciated, explicit integration policies are relatively new in Europe, and in some ways the United States, through its Americanization program at the time of the First World War, really pioneered this. In March 2006, the interior ministers of the six largest EU countries, six, agreed to pursue the idea of a harmonized integration contract at the EU level. And one of the first initiatives of the French presidency in 2008 was to propose a comprehensive, compulsory EU integration program. The compulsory part was dropped, they couldn't get it through, but the European Pact on Immigration and Asylum was passed by the European Council in October 2008, and it emphasized, understandably, three criteria for acceptance and integration in Europe. Language mastery of the receiving country, knowledge and commitment to the values of the receiving country, and of course, access to employment. Much of this activity was generated by a broad-based political perception that traditional, that is non-interventionist or less interventionist modes of integration had failed to produce desired results, although the notion of desired results changes over time. Although perceptions of policy failure on integration have been widespread and politically salient for the French, the Germans, the Dutch, the British, I mean, I can go on, this issue has not been particularly salient for the United States, that is the notion of integration failure. For the French, the political rhetoric of failure began in the early 1980s with the beginning of cycles of urban violence that culminated with finally in 2005, and the policy debate has tended to focus on the failure of the school system to effectively integrate new waves of immigrants, as indeed it's a wide perception in France that the school system was immensely successful in integrating the old waves of immigration, even though the old waves of immigration, as Pierre has made clear, weren't so different. Intensely in 2001 and grew in intensity in 2005, failure has been seen specifically in ethnic rather than class terms. Ethnic groups that have emerged from integration have in fact been successful in the education system. In the American case, the perception of failure merged with an analysis of race was widespread particularly among intellectuals that has really faded since. Indeed, there is a considerable gap in public opinion. There's a considerable gap in public opinion between general optimism of Americans about immigration and relative pessimism in key European countries. The differences remain, and I want to focus on the subsample of immigration is a first priority. And the reason this data is taken, it's taken from the Transatlantic Trends questionnaire, young by 2011, the most recent data that I have. But I focused on among those who mean immigration is a first priority because it means it's an issue. So the difference is remain if we use a subsample of respondents. The question of immigration is their primary political concern. By the 1990s, in the United States, proposals they cut back on immigration could gain no congressional support. So let me look at this for a moment because there are nuances here. If it's just That is the questions here. There are three questions that I took. One is immigrants in general are integrating well. One I want to focus on the last two. Muslim immigrants are integrating well. For the United States, this was not entirely relevant. But there's actually quite a gap between France and other European countries if we look at the results of this question among the general public. In France, there has been general positive support for the notion that Muslim immigrants are integrating well. And particularly among those for whom immigration is a first priority, the gap between France and other European countries is really quite considerable. Secondly, I wanted to point out the gap between that question related to the United States, that's Hispanic immigrants, and because Hispanic immigrants are what Americans think of as the most important immigration population. That is asked that same question, Americans, almost 80%, think that immigrants are integrating pretty, whatever that means. And among those for whom immigration is the first priority, it's now, in this question in 2011, 61%. This, of course, is in the midst of the financial crisis. Integration has been generally been more successful in the United States compared to Europe, I would argue. Although in Europe, integration policies have sometimes been more successful than European political rhetoric would indicate. In France, for example, civil value orientations of immigrants have generally been similar to the general population. That is, in general, immigrant populations, of course, meaning generally, Muslim immigrant populations have had more or less the same civic values as the larger French population. The other thing I would point out is so has their anger. That is, the tendency for immigrants to protest and demonstrate and riot is not all that different from tendencies among the more general French population. More than in most countries in Europe, French respondents tend to have relative confidence in the willingness of immigrants from Muslim countries to adapt to French customs, and even for devout Muslims to adapt to French society. As opposed to their government, or at least some of their recent governments, French respondents place a far higher value on civic and cultural and even linguistic immigration. But I would point out, on the other hand, French policy has not been particularly strong in developing tools for combating discrimination. And indeed, French immigrant populations have done particularly poorly by other measures. In terms of other measures of measuring integration. Particularly with regard to educational attainment. Educational attainment has been particularly poor among French immigrant populations, much poorer than among immigrant populations in Britain and in the United States. In France, a lycée student from a lower class immigrant family has two times less chance of entering into higher education than if he or she had grown up in Spain or in Ireland. American integration policy has grown in scope and has become increasingly focused on anti-discrimination policy, but I won't go into that now because actually, as we know, there's not enough time. Let me move down to border enforcement, because this, I think, is something that is not usually treated. So, okay. Although there appears to be converging political concerns in Europe and the United States about the permeability of the border, in fact, the U.S. border has clearly been much more permeable than its European counterpart. At the same time, the United States has been border control has been very, very considerable over the last 10 to 15 years. Estimating the number of undocumented immigrants in either Europe or the United States is difficult, but there is a European project called Clandestino, typically, which has done some of these estimates. Anyway, let me give you some of the results of this. The estimates vary. Populations vary considerably, but in general, they are generally less than 1% of the population. The estimates of the illegal population in the United States has generally been approaching 4% of the American population. The government estimates vary with the political climate, but in fact, these estimates by Clandestino and the government estimates are fairly similar. The relatively low proportion of illegal immigrants in most countries in Europe, by government reports, appears to be the result of much stronger labor controls, that is, controls over the labor market. During the past decade, the number of undocumented immigrants in Europe has, by most estimates, particularly Clandestino, has been declining, and it's declined by approximately 40%. Both at the European level and among most member states. The most notable exception is the United Kingdom, where in fact the number of illegal immigrants has gone up, partly due to a statistical effect. But it's not the border that's at issue in Europe. It's widely conceded that the border was crossed legally in most cases, 90% legally in most cases, but the ability of the state to keep track of immigrants once they're already in Europe. In the United States, the border is clearly at issue. The Pew Hispanic Center has estimated that only 40 to 50% of those in the United States illegally entered legally through various ports of entry. In both Europe and the United States, the resources devoted to border control and to internal population control has increased over the past decade. Nevertheless, two trends of enforcement seem to be emerging. First, in small steps, the EU appears to be moving towards elements of what Susan Martin has called an island model of border control, that is actually patrolling the border, the external and the border and the border of the ports. In the United States case, there's been much stronger emphasis on internal controls of immigrant populations during the past decade, both under the Bush administration and, as we know, more recently under the Obama administration. The bigger trend is a trend towards the Europeanization of border control in the United States through more frequent operations, internal operations, and a stronger emphasis on formal and recorded removals. Now, I'll end with this, but take a look at the chart that I've posted in front of you. The chart that I've posted in front of you supports much of the rhetoric that we know about the United States over the past decade. And that is, if you look at that red line on the bottom, these are formal removals. These are people who were arrested and who were sent home. That's your 400,000. You're looking at it there. But there is something else going on, and that is not talked about much. And that is generally the total number of expulsions in the United States. That is that blue line that you see integrated into the other lines. The total number of expulsions is actually gone down. It's gone down in part because voluntary departures, which the United States seems to emphasize, has gone down. And because there's been much more of an emphasis on the more formal departures. Because voluntary departures have vastly diminished, the total number of expulsions since 2000 has steadily declined. From almost 2 million expulsions in 2000, the total number in 2010 was just over 800,000. Of course, this does not mean that 11 million undocumented immigrants in the United States were going to self-deport. So let me say this in conclusion. In general, U.S. immigration policy has been far better defined, more consistent, more durable than that of Europe, and has found greater benefit. Neither in mass opinion nor among political are Americans deeply divided over legal entry or integration policies that we talked about before. For Europeans, ill-defined, inconsistent policies on entry and integration have poisoned the political dialogue on these issues and have fed and defined support for the radical right. That finally brings me to the on the other hand. On the other hand, Americans are deeply concerned about the intractable problem of undocumented migration, which has festered for many, many years. Tools used in Europe, better control of labor markets combined with periodic amnesties, are politically problematic in the United States, while the militarization of the border appears to be increasingly ineffective in significant ways. The United States has successfully avoided the pitfalls associated with failed policies in Europe. The question is whether it can avoid the pitfalls associated with failed frontier policies in the United States. Let me end with that.
We'll move now to New York, and we'll hear Professor Peter Schuck, who is the Simon Baldwin Professor at the University in New Haven, Connecticut. He has held the Baldwin Professorship since 1984, and also served as Deputy Dean of Law School. Prior to joining the faculty in 1979, he was Principal Deputy Assistant Secretary for Planning and Evaluation in the U.S. Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, Director of Washington Office of Consumers Union, and Consultant to the Center for Study of Responsive Law. He also practiced law in New York City and holds degrees from Cornell, Harvard Law School, NYU Law School, and Harvard University. His major fields of teaching and research are tort law, immigration, citizenship, and refugee law, groups diversity and law, and administrative law. Now, you know, we have this line when we introduce a very prominent scholar, and we say, if I read all his list of publication, I won't leave him enough time to talk. So this is the case, and I would like to ask Professor Peter Schuck to give his paper, Organizing a Market in Refugee Protection Obligations, Modest Proposal 15 Years Later. Please.
Thank you very much, and I'm delighted to participate, even at a remove of many thousand miles, in the conference. And I appreciate your invitation and also your solicitude in understanding why I could not attend in person. I will try to keep my remarks to about 20 minutes, as I was asked. The paper it builds upon a paper that was written and published in 1997 in the Yale Journal of International Law. And Leah Vorgod wanted me to discuss this problem of refugee protection and wanted me to review the paper and to determine not only to present the proposal, which is quite a controversial proposal, but also to ascertain what has happened in the 15 years since it was published. So the last part of the paper does that, and you have that before you. But what I want to do is start out by suggesting that the refugee protection problem is a vast problem, one that's expanded over time, and we have not made a great deal of progress in approaching the basic problem of refugee protection. It's really a movement from crisis to crisis. The most contemporary crisis is in Syria, where more than a million refugees have fled the country and are being housed. How much protection they're receiving beyond the mere housing in tents is a real question. But there are now over a million refugees from Syria and an additional scores of thousands every week. This problem, exemplified by the Syrian situation, is now endemic. It occurs across the globe. And a refugee protection system, which was designed in the wake of the refugee movements in World War II after the end of the war, is manifestly broken and inadequate to deal with the problems of today, which, as I say, exemplified two important features of the refugee problem. The first is that it's now a permanent crisis, and the system that was set up after World War II did not envision that it would be a permanent crisis. And secondly, it's now worldwide. It was at the time envisioned as primarily a European crisis. Now it's moved elsewhere with a vengeance. So I want to begin by laying out the nature of the problem, which is, I think, grounded in the defects of the existing system, and then suggest my my proposal for remediating that this crisis, not solving it, but remediating, and then finally to identify some of the objections to the proposal that have arisen since then, and my responses to those objections. Virtually all discussions of refugee law and policy seek ways to alleviate refugees' suffering, either by fulfilling or extending the protections to which they are entitled, or by eliminating the political conditions that impel them to flee from their homelands. This approach is obviously sound and it's humane, but it's been quite inadequate for reasons that I will explore. My perspective here and in presenting this proposal is really quite different. Rather than focus on the suffering that refugees endure or the root causes of their flight, I take these tragic facts as given. I emphasize instead the burdens that the sudden massive refugee flows that are now endemic impose on states. I do so not because these burdens are more than the international order taken as a whole can or should bear, they are not, but because I'm convinced of the following four propositions. First, the emerging state responses to these burdens are seriously jeopardizing the viability of any meaningful regime of international human rights protection. Second, any realistic solution to this problem must somehow forestall these responses by easing these burdens in exchange for a set of obligations that states are more willing to accept and implement. Third, this can only be accomplished by distributing obligations more widely and fairly among states over time. And finally, for the foreseeable future, genuine human rights protections, particularly the protection of refugees, can only be enforced and implemented by sovereign states or by other entities such as supranational agencies and NGOs working with these, their assistance or sufferance. This emphasis on sovereign states is a brute reality of which any practical, meaningful reform proposal must take full account. My premise, as I said before, is that the current refugee regime is broke in the limited but important sense that it fails to afford adequate protection to the enormous and growing number of people fleeing from what seem to be, and often are, intolerable conditions, and that it needs fixing. So in part one of my paper, I discuss some of the reasons why the current refugee protection regime is inadequate. And then I summarize the experience of the Comprehensive Plan of Action, which was instituted in the late 1970s in the wake of the Indo-Chinese wars. I'm going to spend very little time today on that. That's interesting and quite a revealing history, but you can read that in the paper. In part three of the paper, I consider four broad strategies for improving refugee protection. In their order of abstract desirability, they are A, eliminating the root causes of refugee flows, B, prompt repatriation of refugees, C, temporary protection of refugees, and finally, permanent resettlement of refugees in third countries. I conclude with virtually all other commentators on this subject that each of these is problematic and that the practical realities of refugee crises and international refugee politics often require resort to the strategies, the last two strategies that I mentioned, that is temporary protection and permanent resettlement, because the more desirable ones, that is to say, of repatriation or eliminating root causes, are simply not available. Then I describe my proposal, and then, as I said before, the objections to that proposal. Because the proposal will certainly be controversial in the refugee policy community, I anticipated the objections and tried to respond to them. At the outset, I wish to emphasize, however, a point that should inform one's reactions to the entire analysis. Although the and this is in italics in my paper, just so you don't miss it. Although the proposal entails many problems, virtually all of these problems already exist, sometimes to an even greater degree in the current system of refugee protection. For this reason, I urge readers to keep the compared to what question firmly in mind as they ponder these problems. So now I turn to the root cause strategy, and I'm going to be very brief in discussing the root cause strategy and the repatriation strategy because, as I said, they're simply, as a practical matter, unavailable. The difficulty with a root cause strategy, of course, is that it is extremely difficult to execute. One must be able to identify accurately the conditions ultimately prompting flight and then be able to rectify those conditions. And I go on to explain what is perfectly obvious, which is why that this particular approach is simply impracticable. In fact, many refugees are eventually repatriated, some within a relatively short period of time after their initial flight. For the others, however, eventually can be a very long time indeed. In principle, repatriation should not occur until conditions of the source country have stabilized enough for the refugees to return safely. So this brings me to the first of the two strategies that I want to emphasize more heavily, the temporary protection strategy and the permanent resettlement strategy. It is temporary protected status that may but need not lead to a right of permanent residence under existing asylum law, international human rights law, and the practice of receiving countries. But although traditional refugee law is preoccupied with questions of asylum eligibility, determination, and rights, the number of individuals granted asylum is but a tiny fraction of those who actually receive protection, and an even smaller fraction of those who genuinely need protection. Most countries of first asylum have concluded that the fiscal and political costs of adjudicating mass asylum claims, granting employment and resident rights while those claims are pending, and permanently integrating asylees into their societies are simply unacceptable. Asylum law, as a result, has become less and less relevant to the protection problem in mass influx situations. Here's the problem. The protecting state may find a temporary safe haven is something of an illusion, if not an oxymoron, that what was justified as short-term relief has a way of becoming, in effect, permanent resettlement. This development is of the utmost importance for the future of refugee protection. If potential protecting states come to believe, as I think they have increasingly done, to believe that refuge granted on a nominally temporary basis is likely to become permanent, they will be more reluctant to offer it. This is increasingly the case in the United States, and I will spare you the description of the temporary protection system that was set up for the Salvadoran refugees, but suffice it to say that at the end of the day, 200,000 or so Salvadorans who were given safe haven in the United States for on a temporary basis ended up remaining permanently, because once they were here, it was impossible, both politically, morally, and as a legal matter, to remove them. As many skeptics had predicted, the temporary protected status that was applied to the Salvadorans and certain other groups turned out to be, quote, a slow way of saying yes. It makes it doubtful that the U.S. government will grant temporary protection as readily in the future as it did to them. So now turning to the permanent resettlement option, which is the least desirable from an abstract point of view, but the one that is the focus of my proposal. Resettlement must be the protective strategy of last resort, employed only when the root causes of flight cannot be prevented or eliminated, and safe repatriation to the country of origin or to another site of temporary protection within a reasonable period of time cannot be effected. Resettlement in a third country is costly to the refugee, who must be uprooted once again and then reestablished in a society that is likely to be alien in culture, language, and in other respects. It is also costly to the receiving country. The extreme concentration of resettlement offers in a few countries greatly exacerbates this problem. It means that when refugee emergencies occur, as they almost always do, UNHCR and voluntary refugee organizations move reflexively, like Claude Rains' order in Casablanca, to round up the usual suspects. The United States and Canada and Australia and a few other countries are where the money is and where the willingness to accept refugees for possible resettlement exist. So here's my proposal, which I call proportional burden sharing. It has four major objectives: the maximization of protection resources, observance of human rights principles, respect for political constraints, because remember, this all depends upon the willingness of states to undertake these protective commitments, and there's nothing in international law that requires them to do so, except for the very limited obligation of non-refoulement, and finally, administrative simplicity. I want to talk about the structural elements of the proposal, the first being the principle of burden sharing. International practice in the area of refugee protection reveals the existence of what might be called a weak norm of burden sharing. It's essentially precatory and hortatory. It's not mandatory in any sense, except, as I said, the very limited obligation not to return asylum seekers to conditions of danger. Refugee flows usually occur with a suddenness, violence, and magnitude that can swiftly overwhelm the resources of a first asylum state that may only be linked to the flow by an accident of nature, its fortuitous proximity to the source country, which is often the case that refugees flow from extremely poor countries to other extremely poor countries, which limits the resources that are available to those most in need. In this respect, refugee emergencies resemble natural disasters like earthquakes and tornadoes. Now, refugee flows do not always possess this random, fortuitous character. In some cases, the first asylum state, far from being an innocent bystander, bears some causal and hence moral responsibility for refugee flows. American policy toward Cuba is a good example of that, and similarly, Indian and Pakistani policies in Kashmir, in which they have contrived situations for geopolitical and internal domestic political reasons that have generated these enormous flows. If the innocent helplessness of most first asylum states is a morally constructive support for this norm, that is the norm of proportional burden sharing, another fact that different states face somewhat different risks of becoming a first asylum country tends to undermine political support for the burden sharing norm. The analogy to the problem of adverse selection in the insurance context, in which those presenting relatively low risk will not participate in insurance pools that charge them average risk premiums, is apt in this situation. No burden-sharing scheme, including the refugee crisis insurance approach, which I characterize for purposes of making vivid what my proposal seeks to accomplish, refugee crisis insurance, no refugee burden scheme, including this, can be effective unless this problem of differential risks is squarely addressed. The risk that any state will become a first asylum country is growing. Ironically, this reality, which is certainly regrettable from the insular state's perspective, presents an opportunity to increase the acceptance of burden sharing. And I discuss the situations of Germany and Japan, for example, which now, and certainly in the 1990s, but even today, face much greater risks of refugee flows because the Iron Curtain, which previously stemmed those flows, no longer exists. In the case of Japan, turbulence in the East Asia situation it creates similar conditions in which refugee flows may inundate Japan with a new kind of tsunami. I say this not to be alarmist, but rather to show that this may be an opportunity to increase the willingness of such states, which have previously been able to close themselves off from refugee protection, may now have a greater incentive to operate. Once we move beyond temporary protection to permanent resettlement, as noted above, only Scandinavia, the United States, Canada, and a few other states offer it to a significant number of refugees. So there's this very dramatic differential among states with respect to their willingness to offer permanent resettlement. So turning again to the refugee burden, the proportional refugee burden sharing norm, the question is, what should be the actual content of the norm? Here I argue that no state should be obliged to participate in the burden sharing scheme unless it voluntarily undertakes to do so. This is a concession not only to practical politics and the weakness of international law, but also to a concern that states both feel a genuine commitment to the enterprise and take responsibility for its success and failure. The proportionality principle is both a norm of fairness and a constraint dictated by political prudence. It demands that a state's share of the burden be limited to its burden-bearing capacity relative to that of all other states in the international community. Rough proportionality is probably essential to both consent by states and to their broad participation. So that's the basic norm that I'm seeking to advance, which is only weakly protected in international law and practice. The second element is the needs assessment process. That is to say, how do we determine how much protection is needed and how much protection can be afforded by individual states? And again, in the interest of brevity, I will skip that. I laid it out in some detail. Moving to the third issue, which is the criteria for allocating the protection burden among states. Here I argue that national wealth is a compelling index. I consider some other plausible criteria that might be used, but it really comes down to oversimplify to the wealth that is possessed by countries who might engage in refugee protection. The attractiveness of national wealth as the sole criterion for assigning refugee protection quotas is especially great in a system like the one I propose here, which would allow a state to pay other states to provide those protection services that it cannot or will not provide in its own territory. I then discuss two exemptions from the obligation that I would impose. The first is that no quota should be assigned to a state that engages in systematic violations of human rights. And the second is that states whose wealth falls below some minimal level, as determined by international agencies, should not be required to participate allowed to participate in this system. The fourth element of the scheme is the market in refugee protection quotas, which I would establish. Once a state receives its quota, it must decide whether it will discharge it by offering protection to refugees, either temporary safe haven or permanent resettlement, on its own territory, and, if so, which form of protection it will provide, that is to say, temporary protection or permanent resettlement. It must then identify the particular refugees whom it will protect. Under my proposal, the state would have an additional option. Rather than protect the quota refugees itself, presumably but not necessarily on its own territory, it could transfer part of or all of its quota obligation to another state in a voluntary public transaction. Why might states enter into such transactions? As in any voluntary exchange, the parties will only do so if the exchange makes each of them better off, and it is entirely possible that no deals would in fact be struck. Even in this case, however, refugee protection will still be better off than under the existing system because of the quota state's commitments to its initial quota. Here, the transferor can only induce the transferee to accept the transferor's obligation to protect refugees by paying the transferee enough to compensate it for the additional burden of accepting the transferor's quota. This is precisely why interstate heterogeneity with respect to both their attitudes toward refugees and their resources for dealing with the refugee burden can, under my scheme, be a policy virtue. If you consider the example of Japan, for example, which does not accept immigrants to any significant extent, and those that it accepts are almost always ethnic Japanese, it is a wealthy country that might well be prepared to pay other countries to accept immigrants whom Japan does not want, refugees whom Japan, for a lot of reasons having to do with the nature of its ethnic self-definition and other factors, would not want to accept. By facilitating voluntary trades, moreover, the quota market could reduce the overall cost of the refugee protection system, giving it more bang for the buck. First, it would tend to move protection programs from higher cost states to lower cost ones, enabling more refugees to be protected for any given resource level. The other side of the market, potential transferee states, should be reasonably crowded. All states want and most desperately need the hard currency that the high quota states would presumably use to pay for their quota discharges, although transferee states might also value other forms of payments, such as trade advantages and others. There are a variety of carrots and sticks that the transferor countries could employ. A potential source of uncertainty in a quota market is the identity of the particular refugees who comprise a state's tradable quotas. This is a problem that I won't get into here, but it's an important and difficult problem to solve because information about particular refugees, if available to the states that are participating in this market, lends itself to discriminatory group judgment by receiving states. This problem seems inescapable, and it certainly exists under the current system. It probably can't be resolved without further analysis and experience, and I suggest in the paper some ways in which this might be approached. Finally, it would be necessary to establish an international authority, and I suggest doing so on a regional basis for reasons that I explain. Now, very briefly, because time is passing, I will quickly review the objections to this proposal that I anticipated and that have actually appeared in the literature since my proposal was published. The three most important ones are that the scheme is unworkable, that the quality of protection and refugees in the transferee states would be inadequate, and the commodification objection. The unworkability objection really consists of three somewhat distinct points concerning incentives, administrability, and enforceability. I think, again, in the interest of time, I will move on to administrability, in which I discuss a variety of market schemes that have been used to allocate various burdens in other areas of public policy and in other parts of the world. The most familiar to you will probably be the EU carbon trading system. But in the United States, there have been a number of others that I describe. Emissions permits under the Clean Air Act and the fair share requirement under the certain affordable housing programs in New Jersey and in other states. But I won't dwell on those now. As with other international agreements, enforceability in the end will depend largely on the degree to which powerful states wish to see the system implemented and are prepared to press other states to comply. The second objection has to do with the quality of protection that would be afforded to refugees by states that are only accepting them in exchange for certain payments of one kind or another by the transferor state. Under the current voluntary system, receiving states may fail to provide refugees with the full protections to which international law entitles them. Indeed, this is a very consistent pattern of abuse of refugees by states that don't want them there for a variety of internal and ethnically oriented reasons. This is a genuine risk, but it is not peculiar to the quota market proposal. Indeed, the risk attaches to any move toward more universal burden sharing that brings previously non-participating states into the refugee protection system. There are several techniques for minimizing the risk. They can't wholly eliminate it, but they would, I think, reduce that risk somewhat. And again, under the current system, a refugee confronts essentially the same options, with the difference being that there is a higher ex-ante probability that the offering state will be an attractive one in which to live. The refugee's options are limited because her rights under international law are limited. She is entitled, as I said before, only to non-refoulement and the other basic protections afforded by the Refugee Convention. She has no right to receive those protections in any particular state. And then finally, I turn to the commodification objection, most recently put forth by Michael Sandel in his recent book, What Money Can't Buy, The Moral Limits of Markets. And this is what he says about my proposal. He says, there is something distasteful about a market in refugees, even if it leads to more refugees finding asylum. But what exactly is objectionable about it? It has something to do with the fact that a market in refugees changes our view of who refugees are and how they should be treated. It encourages the participants, the buyers, the sellers, and also those whose asylum is being haggled over, to think of refugees as burdens to be unloaded or as revenue sources rather than as human beings in peril. One might acknowledge the degrading effect of a market in refugees and still conclude that the scheme does more good than harm. But what the example illustrates is that markets are not mere mechanisms. They embody certain norms. They presuppose and promote certain ways of valuing the goods being exchanged. And I'll conclude by giving my four quick responses to this objection. First, the objection is a familiar one that society has often rejected for good reasons. It is made whenever the market is used to allocate scarce goods or activities, organ transplants, education, environmental controls, communication spectra, childbearing as with surrogacy, low-cost housing, to name just a few examples, that have traditionally been allocated, at least ostensibly, through administrative or other non-market mechanisms. In each of these cases, money changes hands as an inducement in ways that promote socially desirable outcomes, without any obvious, to me at least, without any obvious devaluation of human life in the process. Quite the contrary, human values, and this is certainly true with refugee protection, are thereby enhanced if more refugees are protected through a scheme like mine. Second, the commodification objection implies that the relevant comparison is between a callous market-based system that would arbitrarily allocate refugees to diverse places and faiths and a more rational system that allocates them according to some exalted principle of justice. In reality, of course, the existing refugee system does not even pretend to approach such an ideal. Third, the proposed system is perfectly compatible with whatever regulatory protections and market constraints are thought conducive to securing overriding public values. And finally, the commodification argument would fail even on its own terms if the market-based system actually succeeded in protecting more refugees with a quality of protection no worse and at a lower cost than in the current system. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Comments, but I think we just thank all the participants and wish you a good evening.